he had to rise from the dead. But he gave his life. He died that we might not die. His body went to the grave that ours will not go to the grave. And then he went into the underworld and destroyed principalities and powers that were holding us. And he left Satan completely destroyed. Are you people listening? It says he spoiled principalities and powers and triumphed over them in the underworld. So when he came out of the grave, Satan was finished. Demons were finished. He left them completely powerless. His death destroyed Satan. I really want to focus on Jesus rose from the dead. Therefore, we are not to fear death. Every one of us is going to face that moment. And I pray you remember my message from tonight. All right. I want you all to go to Philippians 3. And we're going to read together verse 10. Together. I want you all to read this together, because that is the cry we see out of the heart of Paul the Apostle, that eventually you will be crying for the same thing. That we want to know this one thing in our lives. Continually. All right? You're all in Philippians 3. I want you to read with me verse 10. If you're there, say yes. All right, let's begin out loud. That I may know him and the power of his. One more time, repeat the whole thing. That I may know and the power of his. One more time. That I may know and. Now he continues to say something that I am praying for my own life, that I pray God will give me. Now Paul the Apostle prayed for it when he was about 56 or 57 years old. He was not in his 20s when he wrote this. For he said, beyond that, he said something powerful. And the fellowship of his sufferings. The fellowship of his sufferings is something no one talks about. And that's not my message for tonight. One day I will talk about this, because I think I must. But let's focus on, it's our cry to know the power of his resurrection. But notice this amazing desire, great desire of Paul the Apostle, where he says that it's only possible to know the power of his resurrection if you know him. Because the first thing he said, that I may know him. And then I will know the power of his resurrection. So when you walk through a graveyard and you see the grave of some loved one, you will not feel sorrow. You'll not feel loss. You'll not go back to that grave and put flowers, because they're not there. They're not there. If they are saints of God, they have never been there. Never been there for a second. Never been in the casket. That I may know the Lord and the power of his resurrection. But first, we must know him. And how do we get to know him? Well, go to 2 Peter. All of you. 2 Peter. Oh, how I love the Bible. And I know you do too. All right. In 2 Peter, and I'm going to read chapter 1 and verse 3. You know, I see these preachers preaching from their iPads. I'm still old-fashioned. Even though some of those verses I can't even see too well, because they're colored with so many colors, like the rainbow, I have to really look to see, to make sure I can see it. Maybe someday I'll get delivered. No, I don't want to be delivered. I love it too much to be delivered. But, you know, anyways, as you get older, you're like wanting to look to make sure you're reading it right, you know. 2 Peter 1:3 says this. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. In other words, everything you can have to be victorious in the Christian life through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. So he has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through his word, through the knowledge of him that has called us. So here it again clearly states, you cannot know the power of his resurrection till you know him. So the divine promise of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus runs through the entire scripture. It's like a continuous thread in the Old and New Testament. So when someone says to me, well, I've not read parts of the Old Covenant because I don't understand it, I think what they're missing, so many amazing revelations they're missing in the Old Covenant, because the Old Testament is a revelation of the Messiah completely. And you know, you have to remember and remind yourself that the early church that has so much power on them did not have the New Testament to read. Imagine that the whole church did not have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They didn't have the book of Acts, Romans, or any of them, any of the epistles. Well, how did they have such power? Because they read the Old Covenant. They found Jesus in Genesis. They found Jesus in Exodus. They found the Lord Jesus in Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. They found the Lord in Joshua and Judges and Ruth. They found him in the Word. So when people do not read parts of the Old Testament, I just finished reading. I'm actually already into Job. I just began reading my Bible. I'm not kidding you, about 30 days ago. I'm already in Job in 30 days. You say, why do that? Because I want to. Boy, you're good, brother. You're good. So when you read, just for a second, yeah. When you read Chronicles, when you get into Chronicles and you get into the genealogies and you focus on what the Holy Spirit is trying to do with that amazing genealogy, he is trying to present the Messiah. He focuses on the genealogy of Judah, the Messiah. But why? To bring you to that place to understand that the whole Bible is a revelation of one person. His name is Jesus. So through Genesis, you see Jesus. Through Exodus, Jesus. And throughout the Old Covenant. But you have to look for it. You have to search. Jesus said, search the scripture. Well, searching takes time. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I want to get onto the resurrection because I really want to talk about this and show it to you quite powerfully in the Old Testament. But first, the New Testament. And here, Paul the Apostle makes an amazing statement, and I'm going to read more later, but first I want to focus on verse 4. And this is 1 Corinthians 15:4. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. What scriptures? Old covenant. So that Jesus died, that Jesus was buried, that Jesus rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Well, let me show them to you. Let's go to Psalm 16. I'm gonna show you more than one scripture tonight that speak about the resurrection, including in Genesis. Well, I'll show you. But first, let's look at Psalms 16. I'm going to read verse 8 through 11. Here is the resurrection. I have set, are you there? Are you in the Psalms? Good. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Now this is the Lord Jesus speaking about God the Father. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory or soul, often in the Hebrew, when you see the word glory, it means my nefesh, my soul. So my glory or my soul rejoices. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Now, let's look at this because I think it's glorious. Now, I want you to see very, very clearly this scripture. I want to break it down for you. But before I do, let's go to Psalm 71. We'll go back to Psalm 16 in a minute. But Psalm 71, and then we'll see that one more time, the entire portion here. But in Psalm 71, verse 20 and 21. Now, this is what Paul meant by according to the scriptures. I'm showing you some of the scriptures to do with the resurrection of the Lord. Now, Psalm 71, verse 20. Thou which hast showed me great and sore troubles, shalt quicken me again, and shall bring me up again from the depth of the earth. Thou shalt increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. Now watch, this is powerful. When the Holy Spirit through David says in verse 20, that thou which has showed me, that which you have showed me, thou which have showed me great and sore troubles. What were the troubles? It was his rejection, his suffering, his crucifixion, and his descent to the earth. You've showed me sufferings. You have showed me troubles, great troubles. You have showed me great and sore troubles. These troubles are the sufferings of the Messiah. Then you have quickened me. You will quicken me again. Alive again. I shall live again. And then he went on to say, and bring me up again from the depth of the earth. Well, that's not David talking about himself. You're going to bring me up from the dead. Resurrection. But wait, we're not finished. We're not finished yet. Verse 21. Thou shalt increase my greatness. Increase my greatness means seated at God's right hand. The ascension is prophesied in those words. Increase my greatness. Ascension of Christ to be seated at God's right hand. And comfort me on every side. Now, that scripture alone is enough, but there's hundreds of them. in the Bible about the Lord's resurrection. And why am I giving you all that? Well, quite simple. So you will not question your own. So you'll not fear death. So you'll know you're not going to be in that grave. Physically, you will be raised from the dead. In spirit, you will be instantly in the presence of the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, I want to go back with you because there's so much more in 1 Corinthians. Like, can we go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 one more time? Because Paul presents an amazing presentation to us of our faith, where he begins with verse 4, and I'd like to continue now reading right through verse 20. We had read verse 4 earlier. Now let's see a little more of that. Are you all ready for that? Okay. Verse 4, that he was buried and rose again the third day, according to the scriptures, which I just only showed you two. I'll show you more in a minute. And that he was seen of Cephas, or Peter, then of the 12. I'm reading 1 Corinthians 15, verse 6. Now, after that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remains unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. The Bible never once says the saints are dead. They're sleeping. Say, I will not die. My body will sleep. My body will not die. Now, I want you to say something else. Say, I am a spirit. And I will never die. Say it again. Say, my body is not me. My body is my tent. And my tent will fall asleep. Simple. Meaning if that tent falls asleep, it's going to wake up. It's the difference when a little boy, this actually happened, true story, when a little boy died and the mom and dad were at the home, funeral home, looking at the little casket of the little boy, and the father who was not saved began to weep and, you know, touch the hand of his little son and he said goodbye, goodbye forever, and walked away. And the mom came and kissed the little boy on the forehead and she said, I'll see you in the morning. I'll see you in the morning. That's our faith. Now, the Word of God goes on to tell us something so powerful. I'm going to keep reading now. Verse 7. After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen of me also as one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. And by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so ye believed. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? That happened 2,000 years ago. Some Christians were questioning it, as many more are questioning it today. But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is vain. yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. And if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. I'm going to read through verse 20. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. What a statement that is. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. The Bible presents us an amazing truth in this portion, that if there is no resurrection, our faith means nothing. Our life is empty. Our Christian faith means nothing. But because Jesus did rise from the dead, then our faith is our life. And more than our life. This is the most glorious statement made by Paul about the resurrection of the Lord. And he declared, according to the scripture, meaning that the resurrection of our wonderful master fulfills Old Testament scriptures and confirms he is Messiah. Now, you must know that all the Old Covenant prophets, all the Old Covenant saints, waited for the resurrection of the Lord in order that the promise made to them might be fulfilled. And the first one who believed in the resurrection was Abraham. I'll show it to you. Let's go to Genesis 17. God revealed to Abraham the resurrection of his son. Not only did Abraham see the crucifixion, he also saw the resurrection. And he saw the crucifixion, if you recall, when he was on his way to the mountains of Moriah. And his son said, I see the fire, the wood, where is the sacrifice? He said, the Lord will provide himself a lamb. He saw the cross, and Jesus in John said, Abraham saw my day. But not only did he see the cross, he saw the resurrection. Because in Genesis 17, God made this amazing statement. Verse 7 and 8. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee in their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be a God unto thee, and to thy seed after thee. And I will give unto thee, and to thy seed after thee, the land wherein thou art a stranger, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. Now, all Abraham had at that time was only big enough for a grave. All really he had is enough land to be buried in. That's all he had. His descendants, that's all they had. Now watch this. Even to this day, the land God promised Abraham still has not been fulfilled to them. He said, from Egypt to the Euphrates. A partial fulfillment came under David. But the full fulfillment will be under the Messiah when the Lord returns. But you have to notice something. In order for Abraham and his seed to have the land forever, there has to be a resurrection of Abraham himself. I'm going to give you the land forever. Forever means you will be raised from the dead to enjoy it. And his seed. Now, in this portion of scripture, God mentions the seed of the nation of Israel and the seed Messiah. And by saying forever, he is declaring the resurrection of his son. There has to be the resurrection of the Lord first for the land to become theirs forever. It could not be then fulfilled forever without the resurrection. First of the seed and then of the nation. First of the seed, then Abraham himself. Now, this is so powerful that the Bible goes on to give us some amazing portions. The oldest book in the Bible, Job 19, gives us a glimpse of the resurrection, where Job declares something so mighty, it makes me cry every time I read it by myself. Job 19, verse 25. You've got to see this one. That's why when people don't read the whole Bible, they miss so much that's in the Bible. Here is the resurrection in Job. Verse 25, Job 19. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin, watch this, and though after my skin worms destroy my body, this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God. Yeah, wow, I was right. Though worms will eat my flesh, God will raise it back from the dead, because in my body I will see him. And he goes on to say something very, very, very powerful. Oh, hallelujah. Whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another. Though my reins be consumed within me. Meaning, if I should perish into dust, which we all will, and be scattered on the oceans of the world, God will bring our belly, our flesh back from where it is. And people ask me often, well, do you believe in cremation? I don't care if it's cremation or burial, God will bring you back. He knows where you are. Are you listening? Some of the kings of Israel were cremated. Some believers want to be cremated because it's cheaper. Fine. It's not going to change the resurrection. You will be raised from the dead. Anywhere you go, he will bring you back. Did you hear what I said? Yeah. Now, the Word of God makes it very clear where Job declares his resurrection is based on the resurrection of the one he calls my Redeemer. Because if you look at that verse real carefully, he begins by saying, I know that my Redeemer lives, that he rose from the dead. And since he rose from the dead, and he will stand upon the earth in the latter days, now I will be raised from the dead because he lives. For though after my skin, if worms destroy my body, yet in my flesh I will see God, who I will see for myself, and my eyes will see him and not see somebody else. Somebody say hallelujah. Hallelujah. And his resurrection confirms our resurrection. That's what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians 15. So everyone yesterday and last Sunday said, the Lord is risen, but very few know what the Bible says about it. That's why I felt to teach that. That you need to know it's in the Word of God. Jesus truly lives. Hallelujah. Now, let's keep going. Let's keep going. Let's look at what Isaiah said about the resurrection of the Lord. So notice here, Job declares his resurrection is based on the Lord's resurrection that he calls his Redeemer. And the very word Redeemer speaks of the one who became flesh and died and rose again. You can't be a Redeemer unless you died and rose again. You missed that. Shall I repeat that? Jesus could not be a Redeemer unless he died and rose. The very fact he said my Redeemer, he was saying he died for me and rose again. My son Joshua, I'll still never forget the look at his face when he said, my friends want to know how come Jesus is the only way to heaven. I said, you go tell your friends, because Jesus is the only one who died and rose again. And no one else can claim that. No one. No one ever rose again. Muhammad has a tomb today in Mecca. He didn't rise from the dead. All the others are dead. Dead. Jesus lives. He rose from the dead and had dinner after he rose from the dead with his disciples. Even Muslims believe in the Quran that Jesus rose from the dead. Yet they go to the Hajj and they know Muhammad is buried there. But we don't have to go. We have no place to go to see some tomb that he's still in it. It's an empty tomb. Whether you believe it's the one in the Holy Sepulchre Church, whether you believe it's the Garden Tomb, I don't really care. All I tell you is he lives. Jesus is alive, and the church said hallelujah. And that's why we need the Holy Spirit, who makes him reality. My dear son-in-law Michael said one day to me, why do we need the Holy Spirit? I said, you go and now think about it. Why other religions don't have such a promise? Because they don't have a living Messiah. Since we have a living Savior, we would not know him without the Holy Spirit. Jesus rose from the dead, shows up in the upper room, and has dinner. Who else did that? And says to Thomas, come put your finger here. See that this is not spirit. It's a real body. He walked with them, talked with them, ate with them, according to Acts 10, numerous times after he rose from the dead. Yeah, she says, wow, that's right, wow. What an amazing wow this one is. Who else rose from the dead and goes having dinner with his people numerous times after he's been dead? No one. Only Jesus. Mwah! Hallelujah. I'm sorry, I just sometimes get too excited and I love it. And you do too, I know that. But look what Isaiah said about him in Isaiah 26. Whoa, this is a marvelous one. Isaiah 26, fulfilling Matthew 27. And what an amazing fulfillment that was. So if you look at Isaiah 26:19, watch what it says. Thy dead men, are you there? Yes. I know you're here, but are you there in the Bible? Thy dead men shall live together with my dead body shall they arise. Awake and sing, ye that dwell in dust. For thy dew is as the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead. And we know from the word of God in Matthew 27, verse 50 through 53, that the saints rose with him from the dead to fulfill Isaiah 26:19. For he said in this amazing verse, your dead men will live together with my dead body. They will rise again with my dead body. Fulfilled? All right, let's see it. Matthew 27. What a moment that was when the saints of the Old Testament rose from the dead and did some visiting in Jerusalem. Imagine someone's great, 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 great grandmother coming knocking on his door saying, by the way, I just rose from the dead with Jesus and I just want to say hello. Imagine how shaken that boy was when some great somebody comes knocking on the door saying, I just want to say hello, I'm on my way to glory. What a day that was in Jerusalem. But look what it says. Matthew 27, verse 50. This is awesome. Then Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection, because he's the first fruit. They came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. All the saints, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, Solomon, the saints rose from the dead. After the Lord rose from the dead, they all rose from the dead and did some visiting on the way home. How dare you doubt your resurrection if they rose? All of them waiting for you. Wow is right, lady. True is right. Now, God's precious word in Hosea chapter 6. Remember, I'm showing you the scriptures that Paul talked about. He said, according to the scriptures, I'm actually showing just a few. There's so many more. Book of Daniel and then Hosea. Don't be looking for Hosea in the New Testament. Daniel, Hosea, then Joel. He's between Daniel and Joel is Hosea, sitting right there waiting for you. Okay, Hosea chapter 6, verse 1, 2, and 3. Come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn, he will heal us. He has smitten, he will bind us up. That's the nation of Israel that will come into repentance. After it's about the nation of Israel. Someone asked me what up there. Israel is talking about the day they'll repent. So Hosea 6:1 says, come, let us return unto the Lord, because he has torn and he will heal us. He has smitten and he will bind us up. This is Israel's repentance that's coming, by the way. After 2 days, he will revive us. 2 days here is 2,000 years. The third day, after those 2,000 years, he will raise us up. So this prophecy is about the resurrection of the Lord and Israel. That he'll be in the grave for 3 days and be risen on the third day, right there in front of your face. After 2 days, he'll revive. The third day, he will raise us up and we shall live in his sight. This is the Jewish people that will fulfill Ezekiel's prophecy. Ezekiel's prophecy in 37, 13, and 39, he begins in 37 by talking about the nation of Israel as dry bones coming back together. That was fulfilled already in 48 when the nation of Israel came back together, but still lifeless, lifeless. Then they rose up as an army, still lifeless. That fulfilled the fact they became a nation. But they had no breath in them. Remember that? Then he prophesied and said, come, O breath, and breathe. That's restoration. That's the revival that this is talking about. Are you listening now?
Yes.
All right. But here we see the resurrection of the Lord and Israel mentioned as a result of his resurrection. And then you look at Hosea, same book, chapter 13. Oh, that is a powerful one. My. Verse 14 is so powerful, it'll make you shake. Are you there in that amazing verse? Hosea 13, 14. I will ransom them from the power of the grave. I will redeem them from death. O death, I will be your plagues. Death, I will plague you. That happened when he rose from the dead. O grave, I will be your destruction. He destroyed death by dying. Did you hear that? He destroyed death by death. When we were kids, we would sing in Greek, Christos Anesti, the Lord is risen, who destroyed death by death. You see, my brother, my sister, when he who is life died, death died. Because how can death hold the one who is life? Shall I say it again? He who is life, when he died, death died. He destroyed death because he is life. How can the grave hold the one who's holding it? How can the grave hold the one that's keeping it? Are you listening? It says he holds all things by the word of his power. The whole planet is held by the word of his power. Well, how can the earth hold the one who's holding it? It's impossible. He rose from the dead. And he rose from the dead also. Proof number two is his body never came from dust anyways. Don't you remember? The word was made flesh. His body is the word. Well, how can you bury the word? You missed it. I'll say it again. Jesus, his physical body, never came from dust. Because had it come from dust, it would have come out of corruption. So he says in the scripture, thou wilt not suffer thy Holy One to see corruption. Because there's no corruption in his body. His body is the Word of God. The Word was made a human body, flesh. And we beheld the glory of God in that body. So therefore, the body of Jesus is the glory of God. Well, how can you kill the glory of God? How can you keep it in the grave? He had to rise from the dead. But he gave his life. He died that we might not die. His body went to the grave that ours will not go to the grave. And then he went into the underworld and destroyed principalities and powers that were holding us. And he left Satan completely destroyed. Are you people listening? It says he spoiled principalities and powers and triumphed over them in the underworld. So when he came out of the grave, Satan was finished. Demons were finished. He left them completely powerless. His death destroyed Satan. His death destroyed the power of darkness. Hallelujah. Well, how can the one who is life die or remain dead? Yet, the Bible says he did die. And this is a staggering truth, that he who is life would give his life, would actually surrender his life for your life. He said, I will lay it down and I'll take it back. He laid his life down. That's what it means by laying down his life. He said, well, I'm going to take it back. And he did. Now, people ask me sometimes, what happened in hell? Well, I'll tell you. You see, the Holy Spirit left him on the cross. Because the second he took upon him our sin, the Holy Ghost couldn't stay. And he cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? At that moment, he surrendered his spirit to God, the Holy Spirit. He went into the underworld and he faced Satan without the Holy Ghost. How did he defeat the enemy? By his perfection. The devil had nothing in him, you see? The only people the devil can have are those that have sin in him. He has no sin. He is sinless. He is the perfect Son of God. And Jesus destroyed Satan by his perfection. Completely destroying him. And he had to face him. Listen, he had to face him in the office of the second Adam. Satan had the power of the first Adam. Adam gave him the power of the earth and so forth. He had to come now, Jesus had to come as the second Adam and face the one who had the office of the first Adam. And destroyed him. And rose from the dead, leaving Satan crippled, paralyzed, and powerless. Think about that. That's why one day you will crush the devil under your feet. He will give you, listen, Jesus will give you the privilege. Jesus destroyed him and you will crush him. I always wondered why the Lord, would give me the privilege, give you the privilege to stick your foot on his neck, on the devil's neck, and destroy him under your feet. He wins the victory. He wins the victory, and you triumph in that victory. So, people of God, don't you get it? You have more power in your little finger than all the powers of the devil. Because you come and say, in the name or the place or the office or the history and the achievements of Jesus, how can the devil stand there? Stop a second. Stop. When you say in Jesus' name, you say, I come in his achievements. I come in his office. I come with his authority. I come with his power. How can any devil stand before you? When you stand in the authority, achievements, history of Jesus, what demon can stand there? Because in your name means in your history, in your achievements, Lord. Everything he achieved becomes your achievement. That's why it says we die with him, we'll raise with him. So when God looks at you, he does not see your achievements, he sees his achievements. And accepts you as his sons and daughters because of the Lord's achievements. Manta kora pil fam yante. Come on, people, let's have a praise break here, somebody. Come on. I live. Because he is risen. I live.
with power over sin. Hallelujah. Lift your hands and praise His holy name. You got it. I live because He's. Let me have some mic, please. Come on, Dale. I live with power over sin. I live because He is risen. I live to worship Him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Because you're alive. Because you're alive. Because you're alive. I live. I'm not done preaching. Sit down. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Satan is defeated. I'll say it again. If you have a message for the devil, write it on the bottom of your shoe. One more time. If you have a message for the devil, write it on the bottom of your shoes. Don't you ever talk to the devil looking straight. Come on, look and say you're a liar. You're defeated. Hallelujah. Now, let's just go back to the Bible, because there's a little more to give you. A little more now. Woo. John 14:19, the Lord said, because I live, you will live. And in that portion, He was talking about spiritually. Spiritual life. But now we see something powerful later in John 5:25 and then 5:28 and so forth. He is giving us the promise of physical resurrection too. So when you look at the Gospel of John, oh, my Lord. I'm sorry. I just had to do this. If I woke you up and scared you, you've got a problem. But those who are in the faith are just as excited as me. Anybody asleep? Something's wrong with you. If somebody is sleeping next to you, just wake them up. How can they sleep anyways? I serve a risen Savior. He is in the world today. I know that He is living. Whatever man may say, I see His hands of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. I'm glad you know it. He's always near. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within. You ask me how I know He lives.
He lives. Jesus lives. He lives. My
You ask me how I know He lives. I said, you ask me how.
You ask me how I know He lives.
How do you know?
He
Let me keep preaching. Can you handle more? John 5, 25. Come on, people, look at it. Hallelujah. John 5, 25. The Lord said these amazing words. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. And in this promise, he means spiritually live. Then you look at verse 28. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice. So verse 25 is the new birth experience, and 28 is the day when you physically will be raised from the dead. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. You bet you will be raised from the dead. And finally, Ephesians chapter 2. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I said hallelujah. You know, I'm going to be gone for a whole month. Yeah, that's the way I feel too. I'm in Israel in a few days. I go from Israel to Berlin, Germany. I go from Berlin, Germany to Budapest, Hungary. I go from Budapest, Hungary to the Ukraine, and then I come back the 27th. Go, go, go. You bet I'm going to go. I'm 66, remember? She had to correct me, thank God. I'm not 67. I just gained a whole year. Ephesians 2, verse 1. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespass and sins. That is the new birth. He quickened you. Born again. Same thing in verse 5. Quickened us together with Christ. By his resurrection power, we were quickened first. Spiritually. That already has happened. Now, look what happens. Look what it says in Ephesians 5. And verse 14, it says something marvelous. Wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. That day, my brother, is coming when everyone who is in that grave will be raised by the mighty power of the Holy Ghost. On that amazing morning, 2,000 years ago, possibly yesterday, the power of the Holy Spirit flowed through that body, laying in that grave in Jerusalem, first healing it, removing all the scars around his head, all the scars on his back. He only left the nail prints, his hands, feet, and on his side. Jesus forever will carry the marks of Calvary as we see the nail prints on his hands. You and I will not have bodies with nail prints in them. We will not have a body in heaven with an open side. We will not have feet scarred by the nails of the cross, but he will forever. That we will remember his precious death. But Jesus, precious Jesus, lives. It says in Zechariah 14, verse 5, and in Jude 14, he will come back with his saints. You'll be raised from the dead. That ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For we that believe that Jesus died and rose again will not prevent them who are asleep. As a trumpet sounds, the dead in Christ will rise first. All the cemeteries around California and the world will tremble on that morning as the saints come through
and arise from the dead. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So comfort ye one another with these words. That's why I preach that tonight, to comfort you. You may never hear me again. Maybe this is the time God will take you home. Maybe the next few days, who knows? Just remember, no death. He lives, you will live. Would you please lift your hands and thank Him for that blessed salvation? Hallelujah. And you that have loved ones who have gone before, don't you ever again say they're dead. Don't you ever grieve again for them. They don't want you to grieve. They're in heaven with the Lord right now, rejoicing. Rejoicing. My mom, my dad are in heaven. Yes, you miss them. Of course we miss them. But soon, and very soon, we'll be there. Hallelujah. The people I know who are in glory today. Lift your hands and thank God. One day we're going to join them. And this is the moment, this is the time to dedicate your life to Him and rededicate your life if you have not. There are people watching me around the world right now. Thousands of you. Facebook, Twitter, Periscope, YouTube, our social media platforms, on television, on other networks, on Love World. If you have not surrendered to the Son of God, this is the time. This is the time. I want everyone in this room to stand up and just begin lifting your hands and praying in the Holy Ghost. Come on. Just begin praying out loud. Come on, just out loud.